Good evening and welcome. We're very happy to have you here. My name is Bethlyn Houlihan, and I am with the New England Regional Spinal Cord Injury Center. We have people joining us here in the room, and we have people joining us via webcast. And we are presenting the Knowledge in Motion Lecture Series in partnership with our hosts for those in the room at Spalding Harvard Spinal Cord Injury Model Systems with Dr. Leslie Morse, who heads up that group. So we have three speakers tonight, but there are actually four principal investigators involved in this research. So I'm going to share some background about all of them for you. Welcome to everyone here in the room and the webcast participants. We are so glad to have you here for the Knowledge in Motion Lecture Series tonight. And it is, my name is Bethlyn Houlihan. I am with the New England Regional Spinal Cord Injury Center at Boston University. And also, we have a network that's also in Connecticut. And this is also sponsored in partnership with the Spalding Harvard SCI Model Systems, led by Leslie Morse. So I'm going to start by introducing you to Dr. Ricardo Battaglino. He is PhD and is associate member of the staff department in mineralized tissue biology at the Forsyth Institute, and instructor in oral medicine, infection, and immunity at the Harvard School of Dental Medicine. Dr. Battaglino is a molecular biologist with research interests that include the basic biology of bone development, SCI-induced autoimmunity and osteoporosis, and the isolation and uses of tooth-derived stem cells. These cells are able to regenerate neural tissue and have tremendous potential to advance treatment of neural trauma due to stroke, traumatic brain injury, or spinal cord injury. A native of Argentina, Dr. Battagliano completed his dissertation studies at Mount Sinai Graduate School, New York. Author of numerous publications, he has presented his work nationally and internationally. The next speaker will be Hatice Hasterk. Dr. Hatice Hasterk is an associate professor at the Department of Applied Oral Sciences and the director of the Center for Clinical and Translational Research at the Forsyth Institute. Dr. Hasterk received her dental degree in 1988 and her PhD in periodontology in 1995 from Ankara, Turkey. Since 2000, Dr. Hasterk's research has focused on the mechanisms between periodontitis and other inflammatory diseases, including diabetes and cardiovascular diseases, and the treatment of periodontal diseases by regulation of inflammatory response. She has authored or co-authored more than 60 scientific publications and numerous abstracts and book chapters in peer-reviewed dental and medical journals. The next speaker I'd like to introduce you to is Dr. Alp Kantarci. Dr. Alp Kantarci holds a DDS and PhD degree. He is an associate member of the staff at Forsyth University in Cambridge, Massachusetts, works as a faculty member at Harvard University School of Dental Medicine, and serves as an associate professor at Boston University's Henry Goldman School of Dental Medicine. He started his career as a dentist after graduating from Istanbul University in 1991. He completed his clinical and PhD studies at Istanbul University at the Department of Periodontology and joining the faculty. During his academic career, Dr. Kantarci has been actively involved in training, education, and patient care. He is the recipient of 15 federal, international, and industry-sponsored research grants and holds several patents. He has published more than 85 articles in peer-reviewed scientific journals, wrote book chapters, and has presented more than 170 oral talks and posters in dental and medical congresses. And last, but certainly not least, I'd like to introduce Dr. Leslie Morse, DO. She is the program director at Spalding Harvard SCI Model Systems and associate director of SCI research in the Department of Physical Medicine and Rehab. Harvard Medical School, let me back up and try that one again. Dr. Leslie Morse, DO, is associate director of research and director of SCI research in the Department of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation, Harvard Medical School, and the director of Spalding's Bone Health Research Program. Her research, as well as her clinical focus, is the care of individuals with SCI. She is, and many of you in this room are very familiar with Dr. Morse, I'm sure have been touched in your own ways by her work. Her research, as well as her clinical focus, is the care of individuals with SCI, as I just said. She's studying the relation of adiposity and bone health through an R01 grant from the National Institutes of Health. The impact of FES, that's adapted rowing, on the bone health of people with SCI, which is a clinical trial supported by the Department of Defense, and the mechanisms of rapid onset SCI-related osteoporosis. Dr. Morse completed her medical training at the University of New England and her residence in PM&R at Boston Medical Center. She is clinical associate at Massachusetts General Hospital, a staff physiatrist at Spalding Rehab Hospital, where we are tonight, and an assistant professor in the Department of PM&R at Harvard Medical School. Author of more than 35 publications, she received several national best paper awards and has presented her work nationally and internationally. So I believe tonight we're first going to hear from Dr. Bartolomino, if you'd like to come up and speak.
For many reasons, we are very honored to be here. I am personally a basic researcher. So part of my work is deals with the clinical research, but I don't have the opportunity to interact with people. So it's very reassuring to see that what we do actually may make a difference in the lives of people. So our talk tonight has to do with the neuroregenerative properties of dental pulp stem cells, and then their future potential as a neuroregenerative therapeutic agent. This work has been funded Gordon, by a generous grant from
that
the Ellen
actually studied the Melvin, Center for the Cure
J. Gordon
and Paralysis
Foundation
here at Spalding,
that actually in studied the Center for the Cure and Treatment of Paralysis here at Spalding,
and also by
in conjunction with the Forsyth Institute. And also by a grant of the Department of Education.
You know, despite, so our first goal is to talk in general about stem cells.
You know, our first goal is to talk in general about stem cells and what we can do with them. Now, we hear every day new advances in the area of stem cell technology. In a very recent press release, the Harvard Stem Cell Institute just published a new way to derive stem cells using adult cells. And despite all these advances, the actual progress in the use of stem cells as neuroregenerative agents, it has been slowed down due in many cases to the fact that we don't have free access to stem cells. So basically, stem cells are a very rare commodity, and I would like to direct the audience, in case somebody is interested, to the National Institutes of Health has a website devoted to everything you want to know about stem cells. And this is an issue that is heavily politically charged. So on top of everything that has to do with the science behind stem cells, there are answers here to many of the questions that some of us may have or some of you may have with regards to what are the controversial issues that surround the use of stem cells. Right now in the United States of America, we have access to limited numbers of stem cells that were developed before the ban of new stem cells. So that means everything that was developed up to, I think it was in 96 or 98. So there is a limited number of stem cells in the lab that can be used for research, but we are not allowed to develop new embryonic stem cells. And so one of the pushes in this field is how to get alternative sources of stem cells that are not these politically controversial embryonic stem cells. And so what I would like to start is with like general introduction, what are stem cells? Well, stem cells are, first of all, are very rare cells that exist in the organism, all of us. And And they exist because physiologically the body has to regenerate tissues during the course of a lifetime, tissues that are exposed to wear and tear, but also to injury or disease. So there are stem cells in different tissues that regenerate either cells in the liver or in the stomach or in the intestine or in the, or in other in the blood. So the main property that a stem cell has is that it can self-regenerate. We call that self-renewal. So the ability of the stem cell to make more stem cells, which is important to keep the pool of stem cells at a certain number. But then the stem cell can also undergo differentiation. And differentiation is a process by which an undifferentiated or multipotent cell can become different cells. And that's what makes these cells extremely attractive, because in theory, they have the potential, depending on what kind of stem cell we're talking about, they have the potential of becoming different things. And we have in the lab the ability to push them to become this or to become that, according to the conditions how we culture these cells. So stem cells, again, like I was saying before, stem cells can be embryonic or it can be adult stem cells. The embryonic stem cells actually are derived from very, very early stage embryos. And that's why, that's where the controversy arises, because in order for us to derive new embryonic stem cells, we need to destroy embryos that already exist. And as we can see in this figure, at the very early stage embryo of the blastocyst, there is a mass of cells, approximately 20 to 40 cells, that actually have the ability to regenerate the entire embryo. So those cells can be extracted. And we do this in the lab with mice and other rodents. You can extract those cells and culture them, like we show there, and you can expand them. And under certain conditions, you can actually keep them being stem. And you can expand them, and you can freeze them down and keep them and use them later. Once you use them, if they are truly stem cells, they should be able to derive all different kinds of tissues. These embryonic stem cells are actually extremely useful because they are basically what I call pluripotent. They can become anything. They can become any tissue within the adult organism, right? Now, that's as opposed to adult stem cells. Adult stem cells are found in the adult organism in various tissues. And while they still can become, they can differentiate into a variety of tissues, their ability to differentiate is now more limited. So we say that they are not pluripotent, but they are multipotent. For instance, we have stem cells in the blood vessels. We cast stem cells in the bone marrow that can differentiate into different cells that make the blood. We have stem cells in skin that can differentiate into several cell types of the skin. And recently also, we found out that stem cells, a certain kind of stem cell lives in the adult organism in the dental pulp. So again, if we were to draw a hierarchical scheme of potency for these cells, the earlier the stage embryo, the higher the potential for differentiation. So very early stage embryos are pluripotent. We say they can become anything. And then as they lose a bit of that potency, they become pluripotent, and they can give rise to any adult tissue, but they cannot give rise to extracellular tissues like the placenta or the chorion. And then as we go down the scale, we have multipotent stem cells. They can be blood stem cells. They can be other types of stem cells. Our stem cells, the dental pulp stem cells, are somewhere in between pluripotent and multipotent. Now, again, this is a scheme of what, if a cell is going to be a stem cell, we should be able to induce them to differentiate in the lab, what we call in vitro, by using a number of experimental manipulations, and they can become either neuronal cells or blood cells or muscle cells. But of course, that's only part of the use. These cells need to be able to induce in tissue regeneration in vivo, and this is the ultimate goal. So there is a progression of work. We need to be able to isolate the cells. We need any type of stem cell. We need to be able to induce them to differentiate in vitro, and then we need to be able to show that they can also do the same job in vivo. And among the many uses that can be, and I'm just showing a schematic here, they can be used to treat stroke, several types of traumatic brain injury. And of course, the goal is that we should be able to regenerate neural tissue from the spinal cord. So dental pulp stem cells were described in the early 2000s by a Japanese group of Dr. Ton Shi. And what they found is that the pulp organ within the adult tissue actually contains a number of cells. And there is a small population of cells that are that they found out they had the ability to behave like stem cells. So again, they were able to self-regenerate, and they were able to expand them in vitro, and then they were able to make them differentiate. Now, these cells, again, are harvested from tissue, and they are relatively abundant. You can get 20 to 30 million cells per tooth. That's, in terms of abundance, is actually quite abundant, especially if you can expand them and keep them for future use. And of course, one of the great advantages is that it's basically a non-invasive procedure to obtain these cells, because they exist, for instance, in wisdom teeth that are usually going to be discarded when you go to your practice, or they exist in baby teeth of young subjects that, you know, are going to be replaced by adult tooth. So it's a source of dental stem cells that pose no risk, and there is basically no ethical concern, because this is tissue that's going to be not used typically. So again, like I said before, I mean, they have actually a number of characteristics that make them better in many ways than cells from the bone marrow. And they pose no ethical issue, and they basically can be obtained by a minimally invasive procedure. So just to finish this general introduction before I let Dr. Kantarchi give his part. We were talking before about different degrees of stemness for these cells. Dental pulp stem cells are actually a special type of stem cell that derive from the neural crest cell. So these are, the neural crest is part of the early to mid embryo, and cells that form the neural crest will eventually give rise to the entire nerve system. But not only that, they will give rise to all the tissues and structures that make up the head. Not only neuronal tissues, but also bone, cartilage, and skin. So the cells themselves are actually quite multipotent. And interestingly, part of these cells that are originally located, it's a small number of cells that is located in the neural crest that are exemplified here by those red dots. They become a number of tissues within the head, adipocytes, and muscle cells, but part of them survive as stem cells within the dental pulp. And this was actually quite shocking when it was found out in the early 2000s, because nobody was expecting to find. I mean, there are many other cell types within the dental pulp even, but it is very interesting, fascinating that there is a population of cells that remains as a stem population, right? So with this, I would like to let Dr. Gantarci give his second part. And thank you very much again.
Good evening. Thank you, Ricardo. So it's certainly a humbling experience as a dentist to standing in front of like this extremely valuable crowd and just basically trying to talk about the tooth as a source of something that we can actually do to help lives get better. And my task is to basically gear up a little bit towards what we know in the literature and to lay the stage for what we actually been doing with my fellow colleague after me. So the second objective of tonight was to learn about like the, how the dental stem cells can actually develop into elements of the nervous system and how they have been used in rodents with spinal cord injury. So unfortunately, we have to use animals in this type of a research because the stem cells that are generated in the lab cannot be sufficient to deliver the work that we are been trying to do to humans. So that's the translational aspect of that. But as a dentist, as a periodontist, we also have the big advantage of knowing that we can actually regenerate tissues in your gums, in your teeth. So we have the power, we have the certainly the tools to do that, but the literature is just like starting. As Ricardo showed, this is a very recent field. It's only like 10 years past. We have a lot of hope, we have a lot of like the tools, we have a lot of potentials, and we're just scratching the surface. The first question that we should be asking is that why doesn't the injured cord repair itself? And as you look at the papers that we have selected out of the really recent literature that's been actually published on this field for the last less than 10 years, actually, we are just learning not only about the stem cells, but we're also learning a lot about like the cord injury. What is the cord injury is actually telling us? What can we do about that? Until when I was in a dental school in early 1990s, there was a dogma saying that basically you cannot really grow neurons. You cannot grow pretty much like nerves. You cannot really grow these type of things, which is not true today. But we're also learning how the patterns of growth can actually be induced, which is very, very slow, but can be induced. There's actually a hope for that. The reason why the cord cannot really repair itself once it's injured is just because that there are actually several problems related to the nerve tissue by itself. The first one is the inhibition of the axonal growth. This is related to the myelin-associated proteins and extracellular matrix proteins are the injury sites. So there are actually two levels related to the cells and the products of the cells that they actually generate out of these structures. One thing that's actually equally important, even more important sometimes, is that absence of growth factors after injury. So once the nerve is cut or injured, these elements of healing may not be readily found in the environment. This makes it a little bit more challenging regenerative model compared to what we deal with, for instance, in the pulp tissues around the teeth, or the periodontal tissues, or the skin. We have all of these surrounding tissues that can actually deliver these elements of healing, but around the nerve, we don't have that much availability. So that's a first challenge. The goals for promoting functional recovery. When we were preparing for this talk, we thought there were lots of goals that we actually put similar to other tissues that can be recovered or regenerated just like other parts of the body. But in essence, there's actually really one goal, which is the regaining the ability to send both ways the signal transmission across the injured cord. So that's the ultimate goal. And until you reach that goal, you haven't really reached what you actually wanted to do in this business. So there are not really goals. There's actually one major goal. As I said, unfortunately, we have to use animals for this field. Hopefully, our students, our basically followers, will not have to use injury models in animals. We can actually transfer a lot of stuff in the cells in laboratories, but that's not possible at this point. So currently, we're using adult rats, as you see on this left-hand corner. And there's a like the injury that can be the typical injury. There are several models, but typical injury is actually really involving the laminectomy between the 9th and the 11th thoracic vertebrae. And the dura is being opened, spinal cord is being transected using a surgical blade, and then severed ends of the cord actually immediately retract. That's one of the challenges. But it also represents pretty much what we actually can do. So the right-hand side is actually pretty much what we want to see. Once we can deliver an agent, once we can actually deliver a group of cells into the injured area, we expect them to either stimulate or convert into the cells of the neuronal source. This is critical because once you start using this, for instance, in a burnt skin model or a tooth model or like any other internal organ, there can be scaffolds that we can actually use for this matter. We cannot really use that type of scaffolds in this model, at least yet. So we have to rely on the pluripotency, as Dr. Bataglinos presented before me, of the cells themselves. In a way, the cells need to convert into the tissue or build the tissue from scratch so that they can actually bridge the two ends of the tissue. That's the reason why we have to use the rodents for this. Since we're using rodents, since we're using rats mainly for this purpose, there are several scoring systems. There are several pretty much like endpoint determinations in these rodents. The most accepted model was actually a motor score that was designed by three investigators. This is called the locomotor scale method, BBB method. The BBB score is actually used for function recovery and locomotor testing in chronic SCI studies. The scale is from 0 to 21, represents sequential recovery stages and categorizes different combinations of rat joint movements. Hind limb movements, stepping, forelimb and hind limb coordination, trunk position and stability, paw placement and tail position. I would invite you to remember this when we're actually presenting the next set of slides, because as you see, the optimal point in a rat spinal cord injury model will be like up to 21. Starting from 0 to 5, we're actually going to expect the animals to start move their joints. Next level will be like sweeping actions, dorsal steps, plantar steps. Coordination is a big, big step that we need to move forward. Paw contacts, paw lift-offs, tail being up, and trunk being stable is our goal. Once you reach these steps, as you go up the scale in the hierarchy, you actually gain optimal healing or the ideal healing of spinal cord injury. As you see, the papers that have been published in this field have been very, very recent. So we actually chose few papers that are actually very recent. But in reality, all of the pretty much like groundbreaking papers have been only published in the last 2-3 years. And that's the reason why our research is actually very relevant in this field. And so there's a lot of work that's coming out. Cell is a very reputable journal. It's very difficult to get papers published in this journal. They only publish just like Cell, Science, Nature type of journals, only publish groundbreaking papers, which are actually going to make an impact, not only in the science, but in the public health. This paper that we selected, which was published in 2012, September, only like a year, maybe a half ago, or less than that, is talking about long distance growth and connectivity of neural stem cells after severe spinal cord injury. So there's no application of the dental cells yet on this model, which will be covered by my next colleague. In this model, what they did was basically they took the adult rats with the model that I was presenting you before. They created the spinal cord injury, and they injected the neural stem cells 2 weeks after the injury. Stem cells were co-grafted in a fibrin matrix, so they actually was a carrier, which wasn't going to be really doing anything by itself, but mainly creating a growth factor cocktail together for the nourishment of the stem cells and convert the tissue into a neural tissue. Stem cell sources in this particular paper were actually from the embryonic rat spinal cord. So they use the spinal cord cells for growth of the spinal cord. They tested human embryonic stem cells, which we'll come back to that. It's a very interesting model because you're using the human cells in a rat model. And human fetal cells. So the slide on the right, which is the colorful slide, is actually showing how we actually label the graft survival, the integration and filling of the entire area that's been injured. So that's actually very critical. This paper, because of these slides that are actually showing up here, which I will show the quantification in the next slide, is actually showing for the first time that the differentiation and maturation of the grafted cells can convert into a mature neural stem cells or neural cell model from that. And then in higher magnification in the E and F panels, the third row from the top, is actually showing that an excellent integration and transition from what we have transplanted into these tissues and becoming the tissue itself. So that's critical. And you also see some more characterization of these cells. The next slide is actually very interesting. This shows that in the purple, like the pink line, what happens if you don't do anything? That's a control tissue. So after the injury, pretty much you can actually see, according to the scoring system that I've shown you before, that you can only reach 2, which is not even creating even any transition or maturation of the tissues for that in that matter. But if you use this particular strategy in this grafting method, up to the 6th week, up to the first 4 weeks actually, there's a really nice increase in terms of the capacity of the cells to become integrated into the tissue, convert into the tissue, and create more like a 7 to 8 scale of activity out of a scale of 21. Then there is actually plateauing afterwards. Everything was statistically significant compared to the control group. Then what in this particular model, what they did was they re-injured the tissues that they have generated. After the injury, the tissues went back to pretty much like no function, which shows that pretty much what we have generated in this model is actually real, because it's not like a basically spontaneous healing. So it's not really related to anything else. It's really related to the stem cells that we have generated or implemented in these tissues. So the lower panel of this slide actually shows the electrophysiology. So it's not only enough to generate the tissue, but you also want to generate the tissues to become functional. And that's the only way that you can actually show through the electrophysiological events. And overall, this paper basically showed that early stage neurons from different sources, regardless of these sources and species, are able to survive, so they're not being rejected. They can integrate and extend the axons, which was one of the reasons why the control or injured cord cannot actually regenerate by itself. So there's a hope here. Over very long distances and form very functional relays in the adult's injured cord. So, can dental pulp stem cells be used for neural regeneration? So that was the topic of the next paper that I'm going to show you before laying the stage for my next speaker over here. The dental pulp stem cells actually are very interesting, and we dentists, periodontists, surgeons pretty much extract teeth and we throw them away, as Dr. Bataglina was suggesting. So can they form a hope? Because you're already getting rid of these teeth. What is the advantage of using dental pulp? The first advantage is that you can generate large pools of neural cells for cell therapy. So you can expand the dental pulp tissue, which is very, very small. Think about your tooth, and think about that tooth's internal cavity, chamber, which is the pulp tissue. You can generate a lot of cells even from that tiny tissue that we can actually transplant into the organs. Another important field that can actually make dental stem cells very, very interesting and important for us is that they share many properties of the neural crest stem cells, so that they are perfect models that we can actually use for neural regeneration. There are two critical issues. One of them actually is a very, very important issue. They have much higher proliferation capacity that can be expanded in only a few weeks. So in a way, you can actually take a tooth out, and in about like only a week's time, you can generate a really huge population from that tooth structure. The second major advantage is that there's no long-term immune rejection after the transplantation, because if you think about that, the first paper that I've shown you right now is that one of the key elements is that to be able to have the tissues to get integrated, to transplant the tissues from humans in mice or the vice versa, whatever you can actually try to use, there should be no rejection so that the tissues actually can stand, get integrated without being rejected after transplantation. The second paper I want to show you is actually a review paper that is, again, very, very recent. It's only like a year and a half old, which shows the neural differentiation capacity and pluripotency of the dental pulp stem cells. This paper, basically, on the top panels, there are four panels up there. I'd like to draw your attention to the first panel, which is in gray, which is actually on the left, right here. This is showing the dental pulp stem cells once they actually are generated from the pulp tissue that was from an extracted human tooth. The nestin, and don't worry about these molecules, proteins, et cetera, is pretty much like used for the dental pulp stem cell or like the stem cell capacity. What is really interesting in this slide is this OCT4, which is actually very, very important because a subpopulation of the dental pulp stem cells is actually dental pulp pluripotent stem cells. If you remember the hierarchy that Dr. Bataglino was presenting before, pluripotency is actually higher up in terms of the conversion capacity or differentiation capacity of a cell type or a stem cell type into multiple tissues. And that's actually unique to some of the subpopulation cells in the dental pulp. So that makes it very, very unique. So there's a subgroup of stem cells in the dental pulp, in the extracted tooth, that can actually have the pluripotency, which is not common for many tissues in the entire body. And this is also very interesting because the lower panels actually show the four different experimental conditions. Once you deprive these cells in the culture environment from serum, which is highly rich of the growth factors and anything that you actually want to implement into these ones, they start slowing down, which shows that you can actually turn on and turn off their pretty much like their life cycle. They still express nestin, which is the pretty much like the markers of stem cells. But when you feed them again with the serum, which is the lower right gray picture on each side of your panels, they can actually start growing again, which shows in a way that we can generate pretty much like on and off signals in vitro, in the lab, in the test conditions, and we can actually pretty much like direct their growth patterns based on their stem cell pluripotency. The final paper I'm going to show you is actually, again, extremely recent, again from 2012, is a human dental pulp-derived stem cells, how they promote recovery after complete transection this time of the rat spinal cord by multiple neuroregenerative mechanisms. So this time, trying to pretty much like bring the hooks together. We're using the animal model, we're using the dental stem cells and trying to create a spinal cord injury healing. This paper used this time adult female rats, again, pretty much in the same model that I explained to you before. This time, there are three different stem cell resources. The first one, which is actually at the bottom, is using the human bone marrow stem cell line, which is the most popular stem cell line that's being used in the literature. The second one is the human dental pulp stem cells. I'm going from top, bottom to top. The third one is the human deciduous tooth, which is actually coming out from the milk teeth, if you will, that you can actually use that one. So the assumption here was that since the milk teeth are actually first in their eruption pattern, they can actually be much better sources for that. So let's walk through the slides. So the lower line is actually showing the control group here. The line in gray is showing what happens when we add only the serum into the culture. So serum, as I've shown you in the previous slide, actually has a huge potential of stimulating the cells, but not enough. Again, if you remember, up to 5, we don't really see anything different than pretty much like differentiation. When you start walking through this in terms of the bone marrow stem cells, they're not too far away from the serum capacity. So bone marrow stem cells, in terms of generating this regeneration capacity in terms of the neural structures, is not really that good, according to this paper at least. when you use the dental pulp stem cells, which is like the second line from the top, it has a huge potential. According to this paper, the best model actually comes from the milk teeth. Still, we can only reach up to the score of 8. Now I'm going to show you two movies. Okay, this is a rat with a backbone injury in the lab. It's again from the control group. It can show some pretty much like motion. Pay attention to the back feet. And then this one is actually coming from a rat from the milk teeth stem cell search. The back teeth can start moving. This is huge because, I mean, that's actually 4 times better regeneration compared to what we have seen in the control group. It's not a perfect locomotion yet, but it's getting there. So where are we? According to this motor score that I explained to you before, I would like to remind this to you. The dashed line is where we are. So we can move joints. We can create sweeping actions in the animals. We can create steps of the feet, but we cannot really reach the coordination and, most importantly, a stable trunk motions there. But if you remember, the history of this research has only been like a couple of years. It's actually pretty good progress. So with that, I will pass the stage to my colleague, Dr. Hasturk, who's going to go back to the teeth again. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Alp. And thank you, Ricardo, for a nice introduction for me. I guess I don't have much to say, but I will hopefully get back to the teeth and why we use the teeth and why we're excited so much about the teeth. So first, I would like to talk about our project. Essentially, our project has 2 major goals. The first goal is to develop this neural or differentiations from adult teeth that they are extracted in the clinic, in our laboratory, to establish this cell line and establish this work in vitro, and then translationally move them into an in vivo model of spinal cord injury. And the second goal is that to move them into human, and hopefully we'll have some success with those. So our goal is pretty bold, and hopefully we'll reach to this with the help of this funding and all the support. So again, I think the best part left to me easy and nice, because I'm going to present the work that we've just done. We just initiated. It's a small initiation, but it's, I think, gives us a lot of excitement as 2 different fields. We're the dentist, and Dr. Morse and Dr. Bataglino are the driving scientist behind it. So this worked very exciting. So what we are trying to show? We're trying to show that stem cells, they are derived from the adult human teeth, are self-renewal. They can renew themselves, and they are multipotent. And actually, I will show you, it's not only the multipotency they have, they do have, as both highlighted, that they have their in pulp, those neural crestal cells are kept from the embryonic period as their capacity. And once you put them into the medium culture environment, they can turn into different tissues or organs when you induce them. So they are pluripotent cells, and that's the exciting area of the human pulp. And we want to have the ability to promote them in vivo regenerations in both, of course, the animal models and further in the human conditions. So both speakers talked about the source of dental stem cells. Until this time, I guess people mainly were thinking that the baby teeth were much more having the potential, and it is. It has the potential because of they are erupting first, coming first in the mouth, and hopefully they have the follicle, they have the regeneration capacity much more. And they're highly proliferative, meaning that they can make themselves much faster. However, the best and good news is about the adult teeth, that they do have that capacity, and especially, if, and I will highlight this again, that when these teeth are not with decay or any infection, like extracted teeth, wisdom teeth, that they're not erupted in the mouth, they're not exposed yet, but they need to come out, or you want to take them out for this purpose, they're readily available, so possess these capabilities. So the major thought that you should take this out, from this part is any healthy tooth can be a source for stem cells. So I think keeping your mouth healthy is I can't stress enough here how important. So people were often thinking that, oh, it's a tooth, I can lose it. Oh, it's okay, I can put a denture in my mouth, I can lose all my teeth. I think we should think twice or three times when we say this and try to protect our teeth healthy, because we don't know, we may need them. And we may need them for a very good reason. So that's important. Of course, developing teeth, as I mentioned, there's stem cells from human extracted exfoliated teeth. But there's a little problem there. They may be possibly very good at regenerating stem cells, but those teeth are often having root resorption because of the coming tooth underneath actually resorbs them to be able to create its own space, and they fall. That's why they fall. They get loose and they fall because the permanent tooth actually pushing them and eating their root. So they may not be that healthy to be able to get the stem cells out of it, or sufficient amount of stem cells. So again, adult teeth are giving us a big promise here. The other cell types that we call dental pulp stem cells as a whole, and among those, there's a small group of stem cells that I mentioned to you stays remains from those neural crestal cell lines that they call it dental pulp pluripotent stem cells, and those are very important. When we put on the culture medium, the non-stem cells die easily, and because of the medium, because of the culture structure, the stem cells can grow and differentiate, and that's the potency of these cells. We also have another third group of cells that we are, as a periodontist, very interested in, and we've been working on periodontal ligament stem cells. Periodontium, which means the tissues around your teeth, are the tissues that are holding your teeth. They are supporting teeth. And if any of you have gum disease, you would know about it. If you get infection or lose your bone around your teeth will fall off. And you lose them because they may not have decay, they may have beautiful teeth, but they don't stay in your mouth because there's no tissue to hold them, no bone to hold them. So this phenomenon came out in even 80s that people started thinking, how do we regenerate lost bone? Which we all knew that lost bone is lost bone, never comes back, just like neural cells, just like brain cells. So and there are new techniques came out just to stimulate those cells, the tissues that actually were lining around the tooth, called periodontal ligament cells. There's a tiny organ around the tooth. I can show you that here. If I go down, okay. So here it is. So this is around the tooth. This is the periodontal ligament that has exactly similar characteristics of dental pulp. Here's a dental pulp. This is our pulp chamber, and these are the canals. They all have the pulp, but also these periodontal ligament cells have the capacity of regenerating tissues. Very similar. They're also originated from neural crest cells and mesenchymal cells, that they do have the capacity to regenerate tissues. And so this is a new era in our field, but coming to the pulp cells and having the pulp cells available, because periodontal ligament cells may not be always available, first. Second, they may not be always healthy because they're open to our mouth. They're not open, but because of the crevice here where you floss this area, you may have all the bacterial invasion, and you may have some infection in this area. You know, gingivitis, which is the gum inflammation, is the most seen disease in humankind. So everybody has some sort of a gingival inflammation, bleeding or things. So again, dental pulp here is all protected to, if you keep your tooth healthy, and they have the potential. So how do you prepare? How do we get the pulp out? What we do is freshly extracted tooth, the wisdom tooth, we take it in the lab in a condition, sterile condition. We cut it to expose the pulp, as you see in two halves, and then we use like a little dental tools to remove the pulp into a petri dish and with some medium in it, some serum in it, and we move into the laboratory to start culturing them. And in a few days, they start proliferating cells, and I'll show you in a minute. Are they available? So first of all, what's the advantage of adult teeth? You can keep them as long as in your mouth, because we have shown, there are actually research shown that any age, the pulp cells, if they're healthy, is potentially proliferative. You can actually have them grow. It doesn't have to be cryopreserved. But you can also cryopreserve them. For example, if your dentist tells you your wisdom teeth are pushing your other teeth, it has to come out. So what you can do is you can cryopreserve them. You can cryopreserve a tooth, you can cryopreserve the pulp or the cells themselves. Or you can keep them if they're quiet and not causing any problem, and whenever you need them, you can have them taken out and used. So, and as I said, they are safe. They have been shown that they have still the potential to proliferate, to grow, and differentiate into other cell types if you cryopreserve them. They don't lose their ability. Okay, so this is exciting work from Dr. Bataglino's laboratory. We have extracted a tooth, cut in our clinic, removed the pulp, as I showed you a minute ago, and we gave to Dr. Bataglino's group in the culture, in the medium, and they took to the laboratory to grow cells. And here it is. The first slide is showing that this is a dental pulp under the microscope, and you see the cells started growing out into the medium. And then this is just like a 1 or 2 days, 3 days. And here you see what happens with the 5 or 7 days. They started covering the whole plate. And then shapes of the cells are very important. They're kind of fibroblast-like cells, which we want to see. And what happened next is, as Dr. Cantarsi showed, do they have characteristics, markers of neural and of cells, because these are neural crest cells, as I mentioned, and they should have naturally expressing these markers, even without inducing, without differentiation. And here it is. We have stained them with nestin, and this is the nucleus, base of this cell, and you can see nice elongation of the cell, and that's actually stained with nestin, that it shows the early proliferation, early differentiation marker. And vimentin is another marker of neural differentiation. And it actually stained very well, even with the 5, 7 days cell growth. Then we induce them to differentiate into neural cells, and most mature cells are actually expressing beta tubulin 3, and we were able to show when we add this, when we stimulated them into neural cell differentiation, mature cell differentiation, they're showing the characteristic cell markers, which is a beta tubulin 3. And it actually shows us that if we're in the right way, we can easily induce these cells into neural cells. So it was very exciting for us. So I think the next step we'll try to optimize these and move into some in vivo models. So here I would like to summarize the whole talk. Again, they're very convenient. We have teeth that they're available in our mouth, as you can see here. These are third molars, but it can be any tooth laying in your bone, or it can be a teeth that your child might have orthodontic treatment, might need an orthodontic treatment, because these canines, these eye teeth, are not coming down. So what orthodontists often do is ask the surgeons to remove these back teeth, premolar teeth, to create space that they can move this, because if they're in the aesthetic zone, if you don't have canine, you don't look like a perfect, balanced smile or function. Because canine teeth are leading to the function of the teeth. So what happens to these premolars? They're healthy, perfectly healthy. They taken out. You can crab preserve them. You can keep them for a long time and just tissue banking them, just like other organs like core tissue. So what we do is we extract these teeth, as I mentioned. We remove the pulp. We put in the petri dish and move them into culture area. And we grow them to passaging into in vitro neuronal differentiation, as I showed you. There are markers that shows that. And then we characterize them, as I mentioned, as I show you the immunohistochemistry. Those were the stainings with nestin and vimentin. Now we are actually in this phase. We're characterizing them using different techniques, like flow cytometry is a technique to show the cell lines, how they differentiate into different cell types. And we're looking at what kind of genes they're expressing. And then, of course, later it will come to our in vivo models, which will be an animal model, and then hopefully we'll move into spinal cord injury, brain injury, traumatic brain injury, or any other neuronal injuries that may actually benefit us using these stem cells. And thank you very much for listening to us tonight. And
okay, so I would like to thank my colleagues and the speakers this evening for a wonderful presentation. It is truly a pleasure and an honor to work with these three scientists. I think it's a really fantastic blending of expertise from dental medicine through to laboratory work and culturing of cells, and I think that this team has a lot of potential. My vision, what I would really like to see come from this project in the long term, is that somebody has a spinal cord injury and would be able to go into the room at the bedside in the trauma center, and we would be able to not even extract a tooth, but do a root canal, as Dr. Cantarsi said. Essentially, you could do a root canal, take the pulp, take that tissue to the laboratory, expand it until we have enough cells, and then inject it back into a person's spinal cord injury and hopefully promote neural recovery. That's the dream. And it doesn't have to be, we don't know the full potential of this. It could work in the chronic stages as well. There's nothing saying that work with dental pulp won't have an impact 15 or 20 years after injury. So that's where we would like to move. I'm curious if you all have questions or thoughts or ideas or.
At the beginning of the talk, there was a reference to some very recent news where immersing adult stem cells in a mild acid bath made them behave more like embryonic stem cells. Would dental pulp adult stem cells be affected in the same way? And is there any thinking of using that technique? And what would the knowledge of that technique exists due to this research?
So there is a lot of press around a recent discovery that was announced by researchers at Brigham and Women's Hospital with a team in Japan. And so Harvard released this in, I believe, yesterday. The report is in Nature, is that right? So it's a really, really exciting discovery for the field of stem cell research. And the importance of this work is that, as Dr. Battaglino talked about, cells in the body, we have lots of cells in the body, only a very few of them have the potential to generate any type of tissue. And actually, embryonic stem cells are really the only stem cells that we have available to us that can turn into any cell or organ in the body. And so this work basically reports a new technique for taking an adult cell that does not have the potential and reverting it to the potential of the embryonic stem cell. Would that be helpful for dental pulp stem cells? Could we drive it further? Could we do more with a dental pulp stem cell? Yeah, I mean, I think it's an interesting idea and something that we could potentially test going forward. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you. It's two different approaches to trying to get to the same result. The Harvard paper, they basically are making their own stem cells, starting with any cell, which is fascinating. They take, I think it's skin cells, and they simulate them in myel acid, and they make them now become stem cells. What we are doing is trying to get at stem cells that already exist. And this is just a new source of them. In the end, we're all trying to do the same. Again, the Harvard paper is super interesting because it's also going against the typical dogma that once the cell, that differentiation goes only one way. And it's been shown now for a number of years that cells can be induced to de-differentiate, you know, and other groups have shown that you can do that with certain chemical stimuli. The Harvard researchers show that you can do that with something as mundane as a myel acid solution. So, yeah.
We have some questions on the webcast as well. And one is, my injuries were 2007 and 2008. By the time this science is feasible, would it still work on such an old injury? Has it been tested on old injuries on rats?
So I am not aware of any literature that has looked at a very old injury in rats. Again, there are only a very few papers in the literature for us to look to. The first paper that was presented introduced stem cells after 2 weeks of injury, so that's promising. We really don't know, but I think that there is potential for this to be effective both in acute and in chronic injury.
That's one of the things that's actually very critical with this type of a strategy is that you're not trying to only treat the acute injuries, because it's very unlikely that the acute injury will be like combined with such a treatment modality at this point in time. So that's the reason why many of the really cutting edge research is really like working on the chronic injuries that has been delayed. But of course, in rats, 2 weeks is like a long time for chronic injury. So how that translates into human chronic injury, that's a different question actually.
And related to that, would scar tissue on the cord and metal on the spinal column, such as that from stabilization surgery, make it difficult to use any stem cells for regeneration on the cord?
Oh, okay, it's back. Actually, that's a great point because I was going to just mention about it, and I forget to mention it during my talk. I apologize. Yes, the scar tissue is the toxic to the regeneration and regenerative tissues. And the same thing happened to in the other dental tissues as well that we know of years. If you have scar tissue, that means that you don't have a regenerative potential. You have a reparative potential, but you don't have a regeneration. And scar tissue is the obstructive situation. So how do we come around scar tissue is, in dental or other regenerative areas, we try to grow cells around the scar tissue and have them to dissolve the scar tissue themselves. So I think in neural regeneration, the stem cells have the capacity of getting into the area and expressing their own the regenerative potential to dissolve or disseminate the scar tissue and start the physiologic signaling between the neuronal and external structure. So that's hope. So I think it's, again, the answer to the question, the old injury is going to be the same expectation.
So Al touched on why does the spinal cord not regenerate? What is so different about the spinal cord that prevents it from healing itself, like skin or bone, which has regenerative capacity? Your skeleton has the capacity to regenerate itself in, you know, forever, basically. So there's something intrinsic, something within the cord that prevents regeneration, and it has to do with the cells that have associated proteins and basically laying down of cell products around. And so the early neuron has the capacity in and of itself to overcome all of the inhibitory aspects of the spinal cord injury environment. And it's, we know that in the early phase from this literature, it's very possible that the early neuron stem cell or neural stem cell may also have the capacity to break down scar tissue. I mean, we really don't know at this point. It's something that needs to be addressed in ongoing work.
Are there other questions? We have more on the webcast, so just want to give other people a chance. Okay. When stem cells are used in a spinal cord injury, do they know when to stop regenerating? Is there a risk of creating something like a tumor?
That's a great question. What do you think?
That's a very interesting question, and it not only applies to neural regeneration, but it applies to any other regeneration strategy that can happen in bone or muscle. And basically, the question is, we ask the cells to do this job, and how do we ask them to stop doing that job once the job is done? And people have gone around this in different ways. I mean, we are thinking in other tissues in terms of structure. If you provide the cells a certain structure, the cells will do whatever they need to do to fill that structure, and then they will stop. There are also, there could be like a growth factor approach. It's also important to know that certain cells, once they do their regeneration job, the cells themselves will become different and will start secreting some of the factors that stop that from growing. But definitely, one of the main concerns with any of these cellular strategies is the concern that you could be creating cells proliferating in an uncontrolled way. So that's, I mean, before any of these things become available in the clinical practice, you know, it's very easy to show in the lab that something works, but then it's extremely complicated to show that on top of working it's safe. You know, so you may need to do one experiment to show that it works, and you may need to do 5,000 experiments showing that under 5,000 different conditions, the cells will not be unsafe, for instance. So yeah, that's a good point.
How would this work on an injury from a stroke on the spinal cord?
We don't know. I would presume that it would be as effective. If it works in spinal cord injury, I would expect it, but it's untested at this point.
Can you talk about when human clinical trials might be coming?
What do you think in terms of how many years it would take to go to a clinical trial?
I mean, I'm a dentist, so I cannot really talk about that too much. But let me give you an example about like how much time was spent in the regeneration in other tissues. And from the dental tissues, here we're talking about only one tissue to regenerate, actually. So that's the reason why the field is advancing so fast, because we're talking and trying to regenerate one single tissue. One thing that Dr. Hasturk pointed out was that when you're trying to grow the tissues that are actually multiple organs, such as the ones that are actually around the teeth and within the teeth, now you're talking about multiple tissue types to grow. And this type of research has started with all the conditions in 1970s, late 1970s. By 1980s, mid-1980s, we were able to grow the structures together. So my guess is that, considering the fact that only a couple of years have passed since the initiation of this research, and we already know a lot about like the potency of the different tissue structures and different cell types, most probably we're going to be reaching to the clinical trials fairly quickly. But of course, coming back to the original discussion, is that there are a lot of ethical, political, and clinical limitations. So one arm of the stem cell research is not only like what we can actually do in the lab, what we can actually do in the rats, what we can actually do in the models that we generate, but it's really related to what the legislature's actually telling us and allowing us to do as well. But I'm more hopeful about that in terms of what we've been seeing in only our limited time that's been in this field. So there's a lot of potential to reach this clinical phase very quickly.
Oh, yes.
Testing. I guess I have a true or false question. I was in Mass General last week or the week before and was having a conversation with a nurse. And she had mentioned that if a muscle atrophies, you never get it back. And she said a muscle would usually, I think she said within 2 years. So if the shelf life or so of having an effect on your spine with stem cells is, like you had said, 10 to 15 years. If you weren't keeping your muscles active or they did atrophy, wouldn't it all be for naught? Does that make sense? Or?
It makes sense, but I don't agree. I don't think that we ever get to the point where there is the point of no return. So again, my interest primarily is bone, and I love to talk and think about bone. And bone really retains the ability to regenerate for our entire life, even when you haven't walked or when your bone has become so thin that I worry in clinic about fracture. If you reload bone, the skeleton, it still maintains the ability to respond to the appropriate stimulus 20 years after injury.
But without the muscle to move it, I mean, how?
Muscle's same thing. I believe that the muscle is the same thing, that you have muscle. It's not, you never get to the point where the muscle is all gone. And when you still have muscle, you still have tissue, you maintain, muscle cells also have stem cells, right? Cells that can be kind of recruited in to build, and the muscles that you have can expand in response to the stimulus, really. Do we have the appropriate stimulus to tell the muscle, to tell the bone? And it is a very good rationale for keeping your skeleton as healthy as you can, right? Even at this point. I mean, we want to keep your bones healthy. We want to keep your muscles strong. We want to get you exercising. I think everybody in this room has probably heard me talk about exercise and, you know, mechanical loading and the importance of staying healthy. Same thing. Keep your teeth healthy, right? Go to the dentist. Keep your teeth healthy because we don't know. I mean, it could be really something very, very important that we all have access to.
Thank you.
Hi. I have a question, but first I'd like to give a quick shout out to my kids, Cassidy and Spencer, who are home watching tonight. Anyways, my question is about the study on the rats, and the results showed that they regained function. Is there any way to determine whether or not they regained sensation?
It's a great question, and this study does not really look at that at all. And so all the BBB score is motor function. And the findings are encouraging, right? Because we went from 0 to 7 or 8. But 7 or 8 is not where we want to be, because that's not really functional ambulation. So we don't really want to see sweeping of the foot or, you know, occasional joint movement. We want to see the hind limb acting like the hind limb did before the injury. And so that's all the way up at 21. So there's a lot of work to be done in the field. You know, it's very encouraging. It's a change and it's different. But we want to see more from that. And we don't have really any reliable way to test function sensation, I would say. We can sort of tell how a rat responds to pain, but that's about it. And that's not really what you're talking about.
My name is Gerard Plant, and I'm 39 years post-injury. And I had the good fortune to go to Greg Hospital, which is a world-renowned spinal cord rehab. And when I did my initial rehab, and I was there 20 years ago when I had initial crisis with my spinal cord injury, or related to it. So over the past 39 years, seeing this evolution of a lot of advancements related to spinal cord injury and issues. And we look at cancer research and go back to the 1960s, we see where billions of dollars have been put into the funding for cancer research. And there's still not a cure for some cancers, but we've seen advancements and some cures for some cancers. And so tonight's presentation has been quite fantastic. I'm a journalist as well, and I wrote about stem cells and research related to spinal cord injury back in 1996. I haven't written anything about it since, and I write about various other issues. But because I've been living with spinal cord injury so long, I've been a patient at Craig Hospital so long ago, they still follow me along. I've had a good deal of knowledge from what they do there and that sort of thing. So it reminded me of what I was listening to tonight, something kind of complex, the research going on with stem cells, that when Thomas Edison was given opportunity and given funding to come up with a way to heat a tenement in New York City, him and his lab assistant had over 4,000 experiments. So after the 4,000th experiment, the lab assistant said to Thomas Edison, "We after 4,000 tries, we failed." And Thomas Edison, "We didn't fail. We just found 4,000 ways that wouldn't work." And so we know that we can heat tenements, and larger tenements than what they had at that time. So I'm wondering how many experiments have you conducted in your research related to what you're talking to tonight? And the other question is, how did you come up with 20 million stem cells in one tooth?
Can answer some of that. First of all, thank you for that introduction, because that puts some of this in perspective. And I have to confess to everybody here, because it's something that it's fascinating and exciting to me. In this particular field of stem cells and neural regeneration, the record in literature has been spotty, if you will, like you say, in the last 10 years or so. But in the last 2 years, I've seen very few but extremely significant studies. So I believe that there has been a lot of silent work being done. People have not abandoned these topics. It's just been extremely difficult. And again, literally in the last year and a half, we've seen a handful of extremely, extremely important pieces of work that I believe will leave a legacy for the next 10 or 20 years. So that gives me hope that I think that we could be in one of those stages where a quantum leap can happen in this field. It may not be incremental. It may have been incremental for the last 10 years. I think we are at the point where there could be some significant advances. That's one thing. And in that, you know, I would like to put our work in that context. I think we literally just started with this project, and we are at the stage where we could start making some significant progresses within month, literally. With regards to the number of cells, I mean, that's something that you can do in the lab. What happened with this dental pulps is that you can keep squeezing them for cells for up to 6 months. That is a very interesting thing with this technology, because once you extract the tooth,
and then you crack the tooth basically and extract the dental organ. So you literally can put the dental organ in culture. After 1 week, you have your first harvest, as it were, of cells. And then you can repeat that procedure, take the pulp and put it into a new plate and get a second harvest. And basically, researchers have been doing this for 6 months. And the dental pulp keeps giving you cells. So the important thing is that after 6 months, when they test those cells, they behave like if they had come out of the...
Visiting hours are over. Time is 8 o'clock. Visiting hours are over.
All right. I was saying that 6 months later, the cells behave like they had come out of the tooth yesterday. So that's extremely exciting because that means that we are not in a rush. We have 6 months to work with the cells, to expand them, to do everything we want. So when you put all those numbers together, you get literally, you can count the number of cells that you extract from each passage. And 20 to 30,000 million cells is an important number, especially if you can expand them, let's say, 10 times. And then you can aliquot them and freeze them. And we know we have means to freeze these cells in deep freeze in liquid nitrogen, and they can stay viable for years. So that gives us, again, another edge. We can obtain these cells, expand them, and then we can store them. And then we can use them for different things. I mean, one of the goals of this project is also to create a cell bank, basically. Given the advantage that if you can use your cells from your own teeth, you can overcome all the problems with immune rejection. I mean, we would like to create a bank with everybody's cells, you know, with your name and last name, and they will be there for you when you need them, when we can use them.
Yes, your point is very true. Dental pulp cells were actually, the teeth were not really favored for a while because they only contain small amount of cells compared to other bone marrow cells and others. But now we know that because of their capacity of making more cells, and they're actually making the cells that we want them to regenerate into, and they have the potential, even as I showed you, even without a inducement, without differentiation medium, they have the neuronal markers. So they and they can make themselves even with many passages, almost infinite. So I think we are people, and we also discovering the new capability of dental pulp cells, as if was believed like couple years ago, or 10 years ago, 5 years ago, that they were only few cells, and they're not enough for any tissue organ regeneration.
I would argue that actually that 20 million number is wrong. I would say that it's actually infinite, based on what Dr. Battaglino suggested, because you can technically pretty much like preserve everything to infinity, and that's the potential of using this type of a cell line. And while preparations were actually done for this lecture tonight, we were actually very excited about this opportunity to be like presenting. But we also chose a path not to be over hopeful, because one arm is that science is actually just what Edison said, is actually about disproving things. It's not about proving things. On the other hand, where we have reached in the last couple of years in terms of understanding and knowledge, in terms of using the capacity of where we can actually go from here, is huge. We're only talking about like 2-3 years of research here. And advancement in our laboratories have been extremely fast. And this crowd is actually the first crowd that has seen any of these data tonight. We haven't even presented this data anywhere else. So yes, we should be all hopeful, but we're not there yet. So we should be also very realistic about our goals and where we can actually go from here. On the other hand, potential is huge.
We do have just a few more questions. One is, how long does it take for a division of the cells in the culture?
Yes, different cells divide at different rates, but as a rule of thumb, we say that a mammalian cell divides once every 24 hours, roughly, give and take. Some of them a little faster, depending on what you do to them. And under normal circumstances, they will divide once a day. So you have 20 million cells today, and you will have 40 million cells tomorrow when you come back to the lab, and you have 80 million cells 2 days from now. So that's roughly the way it goes.
And I think we need to wrap up for our... but there are a few other questions, and I will email them to you, and then maybe we can post them with the PowerPoints on the website.